Christmas. Good morning. Welcome to church. I had to follow with the kids and do what they do, so because I'm just a child myself, I've been told. Hey, it's good to see you all this Sunday morning. Are you on Facebook Live? It's good to see you too. The lights are a little darkened this morning, so we can have a good visual on the platform for video and stuff like that. So just take note of that. But it's just going to be a great morning this morning. I hope you come. Expecting. That's what Advent means, isn't it? Expecting. And this morning it's all about the love of Christmas, the love of Christ. So welcome this morning. Those of you on Facebook Live, we want to welcome you too. Thank you for joining us this morning. I'm going to turn the service over to Kat right now. So Kat.
Well, that's not a lot of pressure or anything. I'm not taking the whole thing, just a second.
She's preaching.
And for anybody who wants a little more light there and the pews out there, just go sit next to Tim. You'll be all right. I wish Facebook Live could see all that. All right. So this morning, our call to worship comes from John 3. We got 16 through 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Let us pray. Lord, thank you so much for bringing us here this morning. Please put your hands upon the ones who couldn't be here, whether that be because they're ill or because they have something else that they need to do at this moment. Just please continue to be with them throughout this day and this season and everything through this walk of life, Lord. We love you so much and we need you every moment of every day. Amen.
Sit back down. We got videos.
In a one-bedroom apartment on the humble side of town, there stands a little Christmas tree. Looks a lot like Charlie Brown's. And underneath is one little gift for him and one little gift for her. After 6 months on the new job, they're still barely getting by. So in the way of decoration, nothing there to catch your eye. Both of them would be the first to say,
came to see Mary. She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared, and she was really scared. So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're going to have, what? I can't say good. Mary, you're going to have a baby. You're going to have a baby, and you will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not going to have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager. I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel told Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
I don't know.
A camel.
Oh, yeah, a camel.
She said, this donkey's fast. They tried to go to a hotel, and
they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no rooms. Literally, no rooms.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way, and they followed. When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
then they saw angels.
The angels said, a new baby is getting born, who is king of the Jews.
The angel were singing,
glorious. And then the shepherd said, I think we should go there and meet him. The second, I think, said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes, maybe have to camp out a night. And then the wise men heard about it.
And then a star appeared.
Well, we should probably follow that star. It's pointing down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So the wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
A stuffed animal, like a hippo one that I have at home.
Some diapers, and some wipes, and some milk, some shoes, some Jordans.
Gold ring and Latimer.
And I don't know how it would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and ugh.
I think he probably pooped because the room was very smelly. Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's gonna be our best friend.
I love you, and you're the best baby I ever seen. There, I said it.
The new baby is gonna change the world.
To have the Christmas story told. He the best baby? Yeah, I said it. I love it. I love it. Stand with us, would you, this morning? You guys gonna stand with us too? You gonna sing with us? Come on. Let's sing out to the Lord this morning.
Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat.
unspeakable joy. Praise the Lord. No, we're still doing it. Well, hey, yeah, it's offering time. Before we do that, can we do something this morning? Can we do something this morning? I got a text this morning. I want to read it to you. Not trying to bring everybody down or anything like that, but I have to keep you guys informed. This is about Judy Davenport. It says, this is from Tyra. Mom has taken a turn for the worse, and the doctors want to put her on a ventilator. Prayers that we make the right decision. We don't want to hear. We don't want her to go on a vent. So this morning, before we take up our offering and do all that stuff like that, we just need to pray for her this morning. We just need to pray for her this morning. So what I want to do is, I want to have Tana to come up, and honey, if you'll come up, and Bella, if you want to come up. We just want to pray and anoint these ladies, I think, this morning, on behalf of, I thought that, nope, she's not here, so. We just want to anoint these guys on behalf of Judy. You know how important she is to our church and how much we love her. So if anybody wants to join us up here this morning, please come up and do that. Tyra, if you're watching, I'm hoping Judy sees this. We really just want to pray this morning that God will have his hand upon this woman. She's integral to our church. She's so important to us. Not only that, she's our dear friend and we love her. So I'm going to just grab you guys' hands right here. Father God, we come to you this morning. Father, I know this is supposed to be a celebration morning, and Father, we're supposed to be worshiping, and Father, lifting you up and praising you as Christmas season. And Father, we're doing that right now. We're praying for Sister Judy. We're lifting her up to you, Father. We're praising you for her life, but Lord, we're asking you, Father God, for a miracle. We're asking you, Father, one more time to lay your hands upon our dear friend, Judy Davenport. Father, we adore this woman. We love her so much. And Father, I echo the voices of those that would say we don't know what we'd do without her. So Father God, I pray this morning, Father God, we anoint this family, Jesus, on behalf of Judy Davenport. We pray, Father God, that you just reach out and touch her, Jesus, right where she's at. We're believing this, Father, this morning. We're believing, we're trusting this morning, Father God, for you to do a miracle for her. It's Christmas time. It's time for miracles. So Father, we lift her up to you this morning. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and your precious Holy Spirit. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. 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 We love you guys so much. Yeah. We want to share this song with you this morning. It's Hallelujah.
Come.
Form of praise is hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So now we'll take up our offering. Pastor Gloria is going to come and play her flute for us. And that's always a treat, isn't it? Isn't that always a joy? I love it when she does that. It's just so beautiful. I have some announcements. This next Saturday is Christmas. Do you know if you do that or not? So if you haven't got my gifts yet, you can just have a few more minutes to do that. So I'd appreciate that if you wanted to go do that. No takers? Yeah, rats. Anyways, today is our Christmas program. See, our kids are up here. The church is decorated. The candles are lit. And we're here to celebrate, aren't we? We're here to celebrate Jesus. So welcome again. I just want to thank that. December 25th again, Merry Christmas. We'll have a Merry Christmas on that day, I'm sure. No PM service on the 26th. Again, we're just following the protocol here until like January 9th. We're not having any evening services or Wednesday nights or anything, Sunday schools or things like that. So, you know, but our offering, hey, it was good to give back to the Lord, isn't it? I love giving back to Jesus because he's worthy of us giving to him. And he's given so much to us, hasn't he? He has blessed us so greatly. So this morning, if you guys would just stand with the, you have to just stand because it's doing the flute service, but I just wanted to say you could put it in the box here, you can go online and give online, or you could jump and just mail it in. It'd be great to be able to do that. But we love you guys. Thank you for giving the way that you do. Our church functions because of what you guys do. Thank you for that. Let me pray. Father God, we ask now, Lord Jesus, you bless, Father, those the offering, Lord, today, those that give, Father, bless them. We love you so much, Jesus. Thank you, Father God, for being so faithful to us. And again, Lord, just be with Judy. Just be with Judy, Father. We're not going to have a pastoral prayer time this morning. And Father, I just want to just take this time again. And pray for my mom, too, Father. She's had a little bout, a little battle, too, Father. And I pray for her this morning, Father, as she gets out of the hospital today. And Father, just be with her, too. I love that. I love my mom. I love my mom. Father, just touch her, Jesus. Again, just touch her. So, Father God, bless the gift, bless the giver. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Before we go any further, kids, are you ready for something fun?
Yes. Yeah.
All right. Tim, can you come up here for a minute? Oh, seriously. Tim, can you come up? You have to turn your, yeah, you have to turn that on. Yeah. Tim, we as a church decided that you needed a special present this year. So if you would go ahead and, no, you have to open like right now, too. You have to open it right now.
Are we in the blast area for the kids?
Well, no, we're fine. Tim is one of those guys that proclaims to be a grump and a crouchy guy and all this and the Grinch that stole Christmas and all this stuff like that. But to truth be told, I've never met a person who loves Christmas more than Tim Trimble. So, this is what we've got for you, Tim, this morning.
Oh!
I wish. I only wish. Here, I'll hold the box for you.
Yeah, I love it.
Merry Christmas, buddy.
Did you ever find the Grinch?
Did I ever find the Grinch?
Yeah.
I wasn't looking for him.
On the tree.
There's a Grinch on the tree. No. Oh, oh, see it now. You're welcome. You're welcome.
Okay. Well, good morning. And
the kids are going to do some songs here and there. And then after the service today, when you leave, there's a piece of fruit and a candy bar for everybody. And kids, you can grab a present from under the tree when you leave today, okay? Kids, go ahead and stand up. We're going to go ahead and sing. If you know the song, just sing right along with us. Okay. Kids, did you know the 12 Dates of Christmas song has a behind-the-scenes meaning? Back in the 1700s, when it was written, the Catholic Church wrote this to share the gospel. They were not allowed to share the gospel. And so, my true love in this song represents God, who gives all the gifts. Partridge in a pear tree represents Jesus, who gave his life on the tree, on the cross. Two turtle doves symbolize the Old and New Testaments. Three French hens represent faith, hope, and love. The four calling birds represent Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Five golden rings, the five books of the law. Six geese a-laying stands for the 6 days of creation. Seven swans a-swimming are the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit. Eight maids a-milking point to the eight Beatitudes. Nine ladies dancing represent the fruit of the Spirit. 10 lords a-leaping represent the 10 commandments. 11 pipers piping represent the 11 faithful disciples. And finally, 12 drummers drumming call to mind the 12 points of the Apostles' Creed. So we are going to sing for you the 12 Days of Christmas. Yeah, come on up here and stand across here. Go to the other end. Okay.
Here's number one. Who's geese?
That's number one. We're going to have you hold it up when we sing your part. That's three. That's four calling birds. You want five golden rings? Five golden rings. Six.
Okay.
I don't want. This is nine. 10. 11. And you guys can do that together to 12. Okay. So you can sing along with us with this one too if you'd like. Okay. Okay, go ahead and stand up. Can you stand up? You may have to help her a little bit. Oh, turn around there. You may have to help her. Okay.
Two turtle doves and a partridge in
Griffin to hold up a sign.
What's next? Okay, Tina has a reading for us.
I'm going to sit right here.
Okay, it's fine. All right, just sit down. I'd like to read to you today. See, you can hear me just as good with or without it. Okay. From Mark Lowry, Mary, Did You Know? Heard the song a million times, but have you ever read the book?
No.
Uh-huh, see? You're going to hear it today. If I can get there. I wonder if Mary realized the power, authority, and majesty, that she cradled in her arms that first Christmas morning. Well, I'm never gonna make it through this. Cry baby. Wrapped in a swaddly clothes, in an 8-pound bundle, gaining nourishment from her breast was God. She had just given birth to the one who created her. The fullness of the Godhead looking around with wide-eyed wonder of a newborn. God became a crying, nursing, diaper-wearing baby boy. They tell me every mother counts the fingers and the toes of her newborn child. And we do, don't we? Yeah, we do. And I think daddies do too, to make sure they are all there. But I wonder if Mary realized those tight hands that were curled around her fingers were the same hands, that had formed mankind. Those little feet were the same feet that had walked on the streets of gold and been worshipped by angels, that the infinite voice had once spoken world into existence. On that first Christmas morning when she kissed her newborn child, she wasn't just kissing a baby, she was kissing the face of God. I can't even imagine that. God became one of us with our limitations. He left the ability to be everywhere. He left his ability to know everything. He, like us, had to get his information from the Father. He left his throne in heaven to become a newborn baby boy. What a way for God to enter the world. Who could have devised such a plan? Only God. The only way he could fulfill the law was to become one of us, to be tempted just like us, but to say no to the temptation. Then after saying no for 33 years, he drank the cup, became our sin, took our beating, died in our place, and then rose from the dead. Mary had received her information from an angel. Mary, you have nothing to fear. God has a surprise for you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son and call his name Jesus. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Highest. The Lord God will give him the throne of the father David, and he will rule Jacob's house forever. There will never be no end ever to his kingdom. That comes from Luke 1:29. That's what the information she had. Sounds like a good deal. Her son's going to be a king, but that's all the information she had. But did she know about the beatings? Did she know about the garden? Did she know about the cross? Did she know about the resurrection? I don't think so. Aren't you glad God gives us just enough light to take the next step? He doesn't tell us everything that lies ahead. He gives us just enough information to spread our interest, to encourage us to follow. And the lifelong changing events, he keeps to himself until we are ready for them. Sometimes I'm glad he keeps those lifelong events, aren't you? I wouldn't want to know some things in advance. And that angel Oh, I don't know how much Mary knew, but I do know she knew an angel came to her. And that angel had told her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest overshadow you. Therefore, also the Holy One who is born to you will be called the Son of God." Luke 1:35. The Lord gives us signs and landmarks on our journey. The virgin birth was the perfect landmark in Mary's life. If anyone knew Jesus was virgin born, she knew it. That's one thing she could never doubt. And God knew she would need very strong landmarks as she was walking down the road no one had ever walked before. She was the virgin whom Isaiah had prophesied would deliver the Messiah to the world. I've always loved the smell of barns and farms and animals and such. I was a weird kid. Now this is him, not me talking here, because we all know I was weird, okay? But it's nice to know somebody else joins me. I heard that amen. I was a weird kid. I think I loved that special aroma because I was raised in a city. Visiting a friend's farm was a rare and special event. The smell of barnyard animals didn't represent sweat and work to me. It represented special weekend outings. I think that because of my big city upbringing and the beautiful Christmas cards I'd seen through the years, I had a fairy tale idea of what it was like in a stable that first Christmas night. I've always pictured Mary in her blue outfit with an angelic halo around her head, the animals standing in silent reverence, Joseph beside her, and the shepherds kneeling in front of the newborn child. But I doubt it's the way it really was. Ladies, would you agree with me? Mary had to deliver her firstborn into the world with as much straining blood and afterbirth as the rest of the women who had given birth before her. She didn't have the luxury of an epidural, heart monitoring machines, or forceps. There were only a few farm animals and her husband Joseph to witness the birth. I'll tell you whom I feel sorry for, and that's all the people that were in the inn and missed it. They were there. They were there in the same period. They didn't have to wait and learn about this event 2,000 years later after the fact like we did. While they were laying in their beds trying to get some rest, they missed it. They could have walked right out to the stable and witnessed the coming of the Messiah, but they were too busy with the mundane to notice the eternal. We see that today too, don't we? My dad believes Jesus knew who he was the second he was conceived. I told my dad he was faking all those diaper changes. How did he learn who he was? Did he learn from his mother's bedtime stories? Her stories must have been full of wise men, angels, and stars in the sky. Did Jesus ever crawl up in Mary's lap and say, "Mama, tell me the one about the angel again"? What did he say to you? What did he say to you that night? Or, "Mama, tell me the story of the wise men who bought these gifts"? As he studied the scriptures, he must have seen his face on every page, because his life was fulfilling every prophecy. I believe Jesus knew who he was by the time he was 12. He ditched his mother for 2 days. That's when I knew I wanted to be a Christian, when I found out that God ditched his mom. Now, doesn't that sound just like Mark? Kind of sounds like me too, though. Mary left Jerusalem with her family and the rest of the crowd, and she thought Jesus was with them. But Jesus had stayed behind to confuse and confound the elders of the temple with his knowledge and questions. Can you imagine the panic in Mary's heart when she realized Jesus wasn't with them? She had been entrusted with God's child, and she had lost him. She raced back to Jerusalem to find Jesus teaching in the temple. She started to scold him. "Where have you been? We've been worried sick about you." And Jesus said, "Don't you know? I must be about my Father's business." And she bought it. That line never worked for me. I tried it. I didn't get away with it. My mother knew I wasn't virgin born, but Mary did know Jesus was, and that he was about his Father's business. I believe he was saying, "Don't you know? Aren't you the one who told me? Don't you remember the bedtime stories? Have you forgotten the angel? I must be about my Father's business." Then there are the silent years in the life of Christ between the age of 12 and 30. We don't know what happened. But it makes you wonder, did Jesus ever perform any miracles around the house? He must have. Otherwise, how would Mary know he could come turn water into wine? And they must have had many discussions about when he would begin his public ministry, because when he was 30, he was still living at home. I'll skip a page here. Mary knew Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus knows he is the Messiah, and she walks up to him in front of some servants at a marriage supper and says, "They have run out of wine at the marriage supper. Has your mother ever said something to you? You hear what she says, but you know what she means." I believe this was one of those times for Jesus. His mother simply said, "They have run out of wine at the marriage supper." Then he gave that strange response, "Woman, what have I had to do with thee? It is not my time." Time for what? If my mother had said to me, "They've run out of Diet Coke at the party," I wouldn't think that she wanted me to turn water into Diet Coke. I would think she wanted me to go down to the local grocery store and get some more Diet Coke. But Jesus' reaction leads me to believe that they had had this discussion before. And even though Jesus didn't realize it was his time to start performing miracles, somehow she knew. Because even though he said, "It's not my time," in actuality, it was. Turning water into wine was the first of the beginning. From that moment on, Jesus began performing many miracles. He gave sight to the blind, a new mind to the demon-possessed, legs to the lame, a fresh start to the leper, and to all who really would listen. And Mary saw it all. Jesus never traveled more than 30 miles from his birthplace. I'm sure she was there for the baptism, the feeding of the thousands, and the little boy's lunch, and every other major event in his life. And she was there when they crucified him. Most of the others had scattered like the wind. Peter was warming himself by a fire, denying that he even knew Jesus. But Mary was there. That was her firstborn hanging on the cross. She had nursed him. She had changed his diapers. She had watched him learn to crawl and then walk. She had told him bedtime stories, and she had rocked him and calmed his fears at night. James and Jude, the half-brothers of Jesus, were nowhere to be found. In fact, they didn't even believe in Jesus as Savior until after his resurrection. It would be hard to acknowledge that your older brother was not just God. He is God. But Mary saw it all. She was the first one to hold him when he entered the world, and she was the last one to hold him when he ended his life. Mary saw it all, the birth, the life, the death. And Mary was there to see him after the resurrection. Jesus never asked us to remember his birth. He asked us to remember his death, because though his death, we have found life. By believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are saved. Peter had to believe for himself. Thomas had to believe for himself. James and Jude had to believe for themselves. Mary, the mother of Jesus, also needed a Savior. She had to believe for herself. And because we have chosen to believe in the virgin-born, crucified, and risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we know we have received eternal life. And this, for sure, Mary knew. stand up. All right. Yep, we're going to sing Happy Birthday, Jesus. Okay.
So I just want to say this guy right here has wanted to do this song. This is his favorite song, and he just absolutely loves Jesus, and I praise God every day for that. So,
amen.
All of you know it, so feel free to sing with us.
Stand up, guys. Come on, kids, stand up.
I worship you. miracle work.
The way make a miracle work. The
way make a miracle work.
My heart is full. I couldn't have another bite. I really couldn't. I had a 12-point message to share with you guys this morning, but I don't think I'm going to do it. I don't think I'm going to do it. I had it all planned out. Afton's got the notes put in. Sorry, Afton. But I just, my heart is just, oh. I'm afraid I just ruin it. So, but I do want to share this with you, what Christmas is all about. It's about this, and it's so simple. You know, I think a lot of times I think we as Christians, we as followers of Christ, make things so difficult, don't we? Sometimes. We make it so hard to understand about following Christ. So hard about what it means just to be a follower of His. And it's really all about the Christmas story, isn't it? And it's wrapped up. Kids, listen to Pastor Tom, okay, just for a minute. And this is what it's all about. This is what Christmas is all about. You ready for this?
Yeah.
Can I share it with them too? Would that be okay? Okay, thanks.
Share it with everybody.
Even though. Okay, thanks. Well, God already knows. I don't need to share with Him. He's got this. He's got this under control. And Nick's going to share after Kathy and Tim get done. Nick's going to come up and share something very, very powerful. But I want to share this with you this morning. For God so loved the world. And I've never been choked up about that verse before. He gave us hope, right? He came to give us hope, which was the first candle we lit 4 Sundays ago. That He came to give us peace. That peace that passes all understanding. Then the joy of serving Him and following Him. That joy that's everlasting joy, you know what I mean? And this morning we celebrate the love of Christ. For God so loved the world. Then we've got the purple candle in the front, which is the Christ candle. Aren't you glad He came?
Yeah.
Aren't you glad that God shared his most precious gift of his son, Jesus, just so that we might have life and have it abundantly. I don't know about you this Christmas, and it's a lot more than just the packages under the tree. The first videos, I play that every year because it's my favorite Christmas song. Because it's a reminder to us what Christmas is really all about. The baby Jesus. Thank you guys for being here. Pastor or Tim and Kathy, you want to come and share your skit? Oh, that's, I gotta go down there. I gotta see this. We all.
Hey, I can tell you, it's been a sad year, and we wanted to make some people laugh.
No. Honest.
Okay, let's get some out. Hey, Gail, hold that while I help Kim get dressed.
Make sure the mics are on.
Well,
we'll have to have the mics on for this.
We don't need mics.
They don't need
mics. You're going to help us. We don't need any mics.
Yeah, you do. You want to be on Facebook?
Facebook.
I don't want to be on Facebook.
I was looking up a skit for us to do, and I seen this, and I think, Tim will do anything. So I went out there, I was dying laughing. So I went out and I said, would you do this? He didn't answer me, but he didn't say no. So he sort of got...
I'd always wanted to be in a play and be Jesus, but this wasn't what I had in mind.
Okay, this is our manger. All right, we're going to sing. We are going to sing 178, Away in the Manger. Cheryl was going to sing me and her for me, but she can't sing. So we're going to ask you to sing with us. All right. Can I hold this? I can't. I don't need it. So here we go.
Okay. Yeah. Is that what that was? Is going to church or something? COVID does. Okay, Nick's going to come up and share something that he wrote. He actually wrote this himself. So, and then after that, we're going to sing Silent Night together, okay?
Okay, that's going to be really tough to follow.
I wouldn't want to follow it.
Right. Okay, this is called What Christmas Is to Me. I said, to think of what Christmas means to me, it's not the garland or presents under the tree. Nor is it the Grinch or Santa and his sleigh. It's all about love that was born on that day. It's the promise of a Savior. Born of a virgin, the faith of Mary that was never questioned. It's the shepherds watching their flock at night as Gabriel speaks of the birth of our light. It's the wise men seeking and traveling from afar while crossing deserts and following a star. To bring him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, gifts meant for a king. He's my king for sure. Born in a manger, no room in the inn, wrapped in swaddling clothes, born of no sin. While I enjoy all the Christmas decor, the lights, inflatables, and wreaths on our doors, the movies and elves and dinners galore, there's something that means Christmas so much more. And that something is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life.
You'd stand with us this morning. We're going to close out our service with Silent Night. Thank you guys for being here this morning. May God bless you. Stand up, guys.
Holy night, wondrous song.
have a Merry Christmas. There's candy out there. I'm going to close in prayer. Take one candy bar, an apple and an orange, and just enjoy it. Father, we love you, Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for who you are. Lord, we praise your holy name. Thank you for Christmas. Happy birthday, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
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 Kids, get your present.
Get your presents under the tree.
Also, grab a candy cane off the tree, too. You can have a candy cane.